My name is Carrie Watson, and I work for the Madison County Public Library. Right now I'm at the Berea branch, and today we are going to be making rosemary braided bread and my version of Brunswick stew with deer. So, to get started, this bread is actually a bread that I learned to make at Snug Hollow Farm Bed and Breakfast. It's a local business. It's out on Red Lick. Barb Napier is the owner and operator, and we actually carry her book in our circulation. It's called Hot Food and Warm Memories. It's got lots of lovely pictures. Her bread is very forgiving. This recipe is loosely based on it, but there's many different ways to add to it or take something out that you don't like. So we're starting with some pretty lukewarm water. It's not cold, it's not super hot, and we're just gonna go ahead and we're gonna add some yeast to it. This is a quick rise of the bread. So I put a little more yeast in it than most people would generally find appetizing, but I want a really quick rise. So I'd like to be able to get this bread from start to finish in an hour or less. So. And to that, I just add a little bit of whole wheat flour, just to give it some good color. And I like my bread sweet, so I put a little bit more than a generous tablespoon of brown sugar, and then maybe a little more, and a little bit of salt. I've started using the pink Himalayan salt. It is mined salt mines. And the pink color is indicative of the higher trace mineral content that it has than iodized salt or white table salt that we see so often. And because it's mined out of caves, it has not been exposed to as much pollution over the millennia that we humans have created. So it may be a little more healthy, it may not be. It's definitely prettier. So to that, about a cup full of warm water, I've added a little bit of yeast, salt, sugar, and the whole wheat flour, and I'm going to let it sit for a minute. I'm going to let it foam up, get the yeast active. So we're going to set that aside. So to get started on the Brunswick stew. Now, what is Brunswick stew? I understand Brunswick stew to be a culturally relevant dish to Appalachia. Brunswick stew, I actually read about it in the Foxfire Book, which we also carry many of this collection. There's about 12 of them, maybe more. And these are fantastic folk recollections from people that have grown up in Appalachia, really a good capturing of what people in Appalachia have experienced over the last century or so. So how they lived, how they got through living in Appalachia without a lot of the conveniences that we have, really even up till recently. So anyway, Brunswick stew is a catch-all dish, I think, of whatever meats that you have available to you. So I'm using venison, we're using deer, and we are adding a little bit of olive oil first to our pot. We're gonna get our pot started with the olive oil and get our aromatics roasting. So I'm gonna start out with some celery and onion. I'm gonna put the pot back on the stove so it can heat up. And really, for this dish, you can use any kind of vegetables that you've got. And since we're going to be using a little bit of fresh stuff, obviously I got this celery at the store. Almost in every recipe for Brunswick stew that I've found, you're going to use lima beans, you're going to use corn, onions, carrots, things that people had put up over the growing season. We're going to add the celery to it just because I really like celery. I like that crunch. But you can add anything that you put up. It doesn't have to be lima bean. It can be any kind of corn. You can use dried beans. Obviously soak them first. It's funny how many remedies you hear for keeping your eyes from watering while peeling onions. I've seen ones where they told people to hold a piece of bread in their mouth while they're cutting. I saw no evidence that that worked. I've certainly not tried that. But anyway.
Swim goggles. That's the one that seems to work.
Which one?
Swim goggles. Because it keeps the oils from getting into your eyes.
Right, yeah. Because it's the vapor from the oils that get to you. So. Yep. It also does help, I don't know if you've experienced this, but if you chill your onions prior to cutting, that seems to cut down on the gases or whatever the right term is, the oils. So anyway, and you could put garlic in this too. I just really wasn't excited about peeling garlic on TV, so. All right, so. Into our pot, we're going to put our aromatics. That oil's already hot. It's not smoking yet, so we got that done in time. So you've got your onions and celery. And we'll get that going on a little bit higher than medium. And then to that, we're also going to add our carrots.
What kind of carrots do you have?
These are some really beautiful organic carrots that I did not grow. I did get these at the store, but they are a purple... I've seen them advertised as purple dragon in seed catalogs, and then a golden carrot and a traditional orange carrot. But man, look at that middle. That carrot's so beautiful. You know, so much about what we eat is what we see, and being able to have stimulation just from looking at the food, even before we taste it. I mean, that's really so much of the excitement of eating. But I like to eat, so. All right, so that's sizzling really nicely. You can start to smell those oils coming out of the vegetables, especially the carrots, the onions. The color's just so beautiful. I don't know if you can see that. And it smells so good. So we're going to let that go for about 5 minutes. So while that's going, I'm going to get our meat ready because I want to get the meat in as soon as possible just to make sure that it fully cooks before we start adding other broth and such. So this is a deer steak that my neighbor kindly brought me a deer this season. I don't hunt, but I processed it. And deer is such a lean meat anyway that when I do cut it up, I don't generally trim a lot of the fat off because you end up having to add that fat back in oftentimes. Because it is so lean. So.
How much meat is it?
What was that?
How much meat do you have here?
This is probably about probably say close to a pound.
Say 12 to a pound, you can guess.
And I'm not really particular about uniformity of size and the chunks of meat. I kind of feel like that that variation kind of lends to its authenticity or its homemade-ness. So you can see there's a good layer of fat on one side of this meat.
And you can use different types of meat as well, right?
Yeah. There, oftentimes they did use different types of meat. In the Foxfire book, they've got squirrel, raccoon, possum, deer, pork, all going into the stew. So it really was what you had and what was around at the time. So again, I don't want the pieces too big that they take too long to cook, but I don't want them so small that you don't know that you're biting into a chunk of meat when you take a bite. So I'm going to add this to the pot. I'm going to make sure that I stir it around so that the meat touches the bottom and starts to get cooked, seared. So we're going to let that go for a minute and we're going to go back to the bread. You can see it's really starting to cook now. You're getting a little bit of brown color on the meat. The veggies are still brightly colored, so we're not burning. All right, so you can see now that the sponge has activated and it's foaming now. That's good, that's what we want. And we're going to start adding our flour, our white flour. So even though we know that whole grains are more healthy, and you know, there's many more nutrients and fiber in brown flour, white flour makes a darn tasty texture. So we're going to add a little more white flour than brown flour. We're going to add a little bit of olive oil, because everything's better with a little bit of fat in it. Really, that should have been added at the sponge stage, and I just forgot. But again, this is a very forgiving bread, so. I'm really just adding enough flour to it so that I can handle it. Because what we're going to need to do is we're going to need to start kneading. So I'm really just trying to make it so that it's together enough that it's not going to stick to my hands and make me angry. Okay, I figure I can handle it at this point. So it's definitely going to need a little bit more flour incorporated into it. So we're just going to put some on the table to bring it out to. Get all that goodness stuck to the sides. All right, so this is going to be a small loaf, but I'm going to start kneading it. And the trick to kneading is you're using the palm of your hand to kind of stretch the dough gently away from you. And then bringing it back with your fingertips. So I'm pushing away and I'm pulling back all in the same movement. One motion. And not only is that working out all the clumps that are in my bread, because all the flour didn't get broken down. It's also just a really beautiful way to start stretching the gluten out of the wheat because your gluten is what keeps your bread together. So you're just kind of coaxing it out. It's a wonderful thing to do when it's raining. And actually, there is a link between barometric pressure and the ability for bread to rise. So the lower the barometric pressure is, the better rise you get out of your breads, which really makes sense when you think about it. So rainy days are good for bread baking.
When did you start making bread?
I really didn't start making bread until I worked at Snow Hollow. And I became, for a while I was the, besides Barbara, I was the only cook. And so I had to learn how to make everything. And she really taught me how to make bread. And from this bread, I ventured out into other types of breads. So pastries and enriched breads. I don't really know what to call this bread because it's not a traditional, like, slow rise, punch down three times. It's not an enriched bread. You don't put egg, milk, butter in it. It's not a loaf bread.
it's like an Italian or French bread.
Yeah, it kind of is.
It is. It's the same ingredients I use for my French bread recipe. Well,
there we go.
Yep, with no milk, just sugar and salt.
Awesome.
And a little bit of oil.
Well, thank you.
Come think of it.
A French bread.
Yeah. Cool. French or Italian, I'm not sure which where it comes in, but it's one of the simple recipes.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's without a lot of additives.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Extremely easy.
Yep.
And forgiving and quick. You know, you can get this done by the time the stew's ready. Okay, so now it's not sticky. It's not sticking to me. I don't want to add any more flour to it, though. Maybe we'll give it one more quick little rise.
What are you doing now?
I am spraying this bowl, so it doesn't stick too bad. So we're just going to cover it up, set it aside, let it get a quick little rise in, and go back to our stew. All right. So at this point, the veggies, the meat is almost brown, not cooked all the way through, but you can tell by the color of the veggies that it's really time to start adding some more substance to this. Or we're going to start dulling and taking the crispness out of our vegetables. So, put it back on the stove, get the flour off of my hands, and we're going to start adding our flavoring. So this is another interesting part about Brunswick stew. You know what, let's throw these potatoes in there real quick. In all Brunswick stew recipes, it calls for Worcestershire sauce, hot sauce, and ketchup. And those, I know, like I see your face, that does not sound good, but it somehow is unbelievably tasty. And those are the only ubiquitous ingredients in every Brunswick stew recipe I've ever found. And honestly, for the broth, it is all about those seasonings. So we're gonna add the potatoes. They don't take as long to cook. And the only reason I added potatoes to it is because we had some put up, so. So in this stew, which now is starting to actually smell like a stew, we're going to do some Worcestershire. We're going to do about 2 tablespoons maybe. It really kind of depends on how strong you like the flavor of your broth and how much broth you want in relation to your things in your stew, your meat and veggies. And we're going to add, usually they call for vinegar, but I make fire cider, and so we're going to add some fire cider to it, which is going to boost the health content of this.
Fire cider, what are you talking about?
So what is fire cider? Rosemary Gladstar, back in the 70s, started this whole new movement, well not whole new movement, but started one of the movements of healing yourself, brown sugar, healing yourself and a lot of the health ailments that we were having with natural remedies. So apple cider vinegar, we all know, good stuff. It has probiotics in it, has a live culture, boosts the immune system by helping the intestinal flora. She said, well, okay, what about this? What if we take apple cider vinegar and to that we add horseradish root, turmeric, ginger, cayenne pepper, a little bit of local honey or maple syrup, and let that meld and cook and brew for months or more. And it makes the most tasty vinegar I've ever had in my life. And you cannot tell me that that is not good for you. All of those ingredients on their own have health benefits that we can document and have evidence for. So putting them all together, pretty good idea, I think. So we've added the Worcestershire sauce, apple cider vinegar or fire cider, brown sugar, and I know this looks insane. It looks totally insane. But we are adding ketchup. Yes, we are adding ketchup to our stew. And you will thank me because you will taste it missing if you forgo. So there we go. That can be your secret. It's my secret. You don't have to tell anybody when they're like, oh my God, this is the best broth I've ever had. And you say, no, isn't that funny? So we're going to stir it up, kind of help those flavorful ingredients to work together, kind of make a... It looks like a stew at this point, like a traditional stew. But we still need to add our broth. So. I'm going to bring that back up to heat. And for our veggies, I have brought tomatoes that, I don't know about you, but by the end of the season, I am so sick and tired of canning. And so god-awful hot. I'm tired of all the jars being out on my counter. I've made 20 trips to the store to buy, yet again, lids and rims because they're all rusty. So I started freezing tomatoes. And honestly, I have not had any trouble with them. The only extra step that you have to take is that if you don't want them to be so, add so much liquid, you really do need to defrost them and squeeze them before adding them into whatever you're cooking. But if you don't mind doing that, or if you don't care, a little extra water, it's so much easier. So, I'm gonna add these fresh tomatoes from our garden. Again, food that we've put up to that stew pot. And then I'm gonna add, I've got lima beans. Again, something that that folks in Appalachia would have grown and harvested and put up. I'm going to add those. And of course, corn. You can use shoe peg corn, you can use white corn, you can use whatever corn you've got. Generally, when we grow corn, we don't have any left over from fresh seeding to put up. And my God, that's a lot of work. So, and then I do add a little bit more salt even though you really, really want to be very conservative with this, because remember, you've got Worcestershire sauce in there that's very, very salty. So you've already got an outside element of salt. So I always choose to go lighter on the salt, and then you can always add more if you need it. And then pepper. So we're going to give it a whirl, kind of get everything moving in this pot. And at this point, the meat is still not fully cooked. I still can see some pink as I push around the ingredients. I can still see a little bit of pink. So that's okay. That's really okay, because what we're going to do is we're going to add a little bit more liquid to this. The vegetables are going to seep out their liquid. And we're going to bring it up to a full boil. And that's going to hit the rest of any spots in the meat that need to be cooked a little bit more. So it's going back up to a boil. And we're going to add some chicken stock. I don't generally use bouillon cubes or prepared stock if I'm using store-bought stock. I like to control the concentration of the flavor. And so I find that if I buy a dehydrated stock, like this kind, I can make it less watery and more bang for your buck. So I'm just gonna grab some. And again, this has got salt in it, so you don't want to, generally I don't add additional salt, but we just a little bit in there. And that paste, the chicken stock paste will dissolve into that, and as you mix it, it will more uniformly work in the liquid of the soup stock. So, okay, yay, our bread's totally rising. I've got the oven set on 425 right now, just to, every oven is so different, so cooking with this oven, wasn't sure how hot it would get. So I can tell that my dough has risen because I can press down and it pops back up. So it is already starting to rise, which is what we want. You can rip your dough. Some people do that. Since I'm not going to give this dough much more of a rise, I'm going to try and handle it as few times as I can. And yeah, this is really good. It's pliable, but it also is holding its loft a little bit. So I'm using the heels of my hands to roll these three pieces into almost even segments.
Is there a reason to rip your bread?
I'm just too lazy to pick up a knife. There's really no reason to rip your bread. Some people have a strong opinion about it.
Obviously you don't.
I don't.
And sounds like you're saying it's more for show, but
I think it is. But I want to be gentle with this bread because I'm not being as kind to it as I could be by giving it a rise, another long rise. So to braid it, I'm pinching off at the top. And I do a reverse braid, just to get it started. When you braid bread, I have learned this the hard way. Many frustrated loaves that are beautiful when I put them on the cooking sheet to cook, and I pull them out of the oven and they've got this gnarly rip right in the middle, because bread does rise again in the oven. It's called oven rise, and it's a burst of rising. So you need to give your bread space to rise, is what I've learned. So I'm not going to tightly braid this. I'm going to very loosely braid it so that it has the space that it needs to rise. It's a little bit looser up here than down here. That's okay. Now we're going to put it on a sheet. Now you can also, you can do bread in so many different ways. You could spiral it, you could roll it into one long segment and then spiral it. You do have to pay attention to cooking it a little bit extra for the part in the middle. But this one, you can just slice it up pretty easily when you've got folks that you're making dinner for. So we've gone ahead and braided it. We're going to set it aside, let it rise a little bit more, go back to our stew. So it's not quite yet at a boil, but it's certainly smelling good. Bring it up a little bit quicker. So for this bread, it's really nice to have a garnish on top of your bread to make it look extra fancy and pretty. So what we're going to do is we're going to make a drizzle. Again, using stuff that we've got around, I pulled some sage and some rosemary out of my garden this afternoon. And we're going to just chop these fresh herbs up. Fortunately, these are herbs that are the last to get hit when cold weather comes. Now my sage has actually overwintered.
Sage will come back year after year.
Okay. Yeah, is it a biannual?
Perennial. Okay. It seems to be perennial because the flowers every year. Okay. Off of the same wood.
So just going to kind of roughly chop up these fresh sage leaves. You do kind of want, well, now this is a matter of preference. If you think that you would not enjoy biting into a large chunk of an herb leaf, then perhaps you want to chop up your herbs smaller. But then if you don't mind, you can leave them big and chunky, and it's just so beautiful either way. Of course, the more you chop, the more those oils, those essential oils are released and smells. So for rosemary, we're going to just pull off, leave that one whole. We're going to pull off the individual petals, leaflets?
Leaves.
Leaves.
They would be leaves.
Okay.
Actually, in this case.
Oh, it smells so good. Now, rosemary, I don't mind biting into a large chunk of. Sage gets to be a little bit much, but. Okay, so we've got
such a strong flavor.
It is.
Yeah.
And it's
so, usually so little when you add it to stuff.
Well, I feel like it's quintessential.
And it may grow as it cooks too.
What's that?
The flavor may grow when it cooks.
Yeah.
So it becomes more flavorful.
Absolutely. It's just quintessential to winter cooking. All your lambs and turkeys and things of that nature that we associate with the holidays. I think they just taste so good with sage. Okay, so I've put them into a jar. Jars are like my favorite thing right now for mixing because you don't actually have to use a separate instrument to whir it up. You can put what you want to mix, be it salad dressings. Oh my gosh, fire cider with olive oil. A little bit of honey. That is such a good dressing. We'll add a little bit of salt to this as well. Just a pinch. One more. And then you can just give it a good shake. And those oils are going to start seeping out of the herbs and start flavoring that oil. We're going to let it rest. So we're going to throw our bread in the oven. We could let it go a little bit longer, but it's really a matter of preference. If you let it proof too long before you put it in the oven, it's going to be massive and too much, and it will split. So you just kind of have to make it a couple of times or 10 times and figure out if it, you know, what time management works for you. And you'll get it wrong at some point and you'll do it again and it'll be fine. So into the 425 oven, our stew is just about to hit a boil. You can see the foam starting to form. And it smells amazing. We're gonna stir it to make sure nothing's sticking on the bottom. Once we hit a boil, you can taste the broth. I'm really not a fan of raw meat, so I like to wait till it hits a boil before I start tasting the broth to see if we need to add anything to it. So we'll get to that point. So here's what the bread will look like if you're lucky and it doesn't split too much on you the first time. You can see that mine still did split. And it's a very light bread. You gotta watch the back, make sure it doesn't burn. So we can add, now you can paint, I forgot to do this, but prior to putting it in the oven, you can paint it with an egg yolk and just maybe a teaspoon of water, and that will give it a nice glaze. Or you can just not do what I did. What I'm doing is just trying to puncture a little bit of the crust, and you don't have to do this. But my thought is, then more of the oil will soak into the bread, because it will have some place to go. So you just drizzle that on over it. And if you really want to bump up the aromatic, quality of your cooking, pop this in the oven for a quick second. And what that's going to do is it's going to heat that oil up really quick. It's going to release those essential oils into the air so that everyone will be like, oh my gosh, what are you cooking? And it will smell fantastic. Okay, so we're finally up to a boil on the stew. And we were just talking about this yesterday. Sometimes when you're making a tomato-based dish, whether it be spaghetti sauce or a stew, it can be just a little too acidic. And so that's the reason behind the brown sugar being added. So we're going to taste this. We're going to pull the bread back out, and that'll be it. And that's how you make Brunswick stew and rosemary braided bread. I'm Carrie Watson, and you can find me in any other book that you want to look at to cook from or to experience new cuisines at your Madison County Public Library. Thank you for watching.